Testing 1, 2, 3, 4. Testing, testing 1, 2, 3, 4. Testing, testing 1, 2, 3, 4. Testing, testing 1, 2, 3, 4. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Testing, testing, testing.
Thank you. Committee will come to order. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The committee meets to receive testimony on the security situation in Iraq and Syria, the implications for the region and the United States policy options. Our witnesses include Dr. Stephen Biddle, Dr. Max Boot, Mr. Brian Fishman, and former HASC Chairman Duncan Hunter. I'd like to thank Chairman Hunter for being here today. Is this public?
Yes, it is.
I was going to say that we pulled him off the golf course, but you can do that now. I know that your insights and experience will be extremely valuable for the committee. I don't know how many have read your book, but your knowledge of the situation is very relevant. Also, I want to thank your son, who's not here yet, for his suggestion to get the perspectives of those who know Iraq best. It was his idea that we do this, and I think it was a great one, and to draw from their extensive experience as we consider a way forward. We have a superb panel today, and we're working to secure time this fall to gain further insights from key military commanders who were on the ground in Iraq. Mr. Hunter, Jr., like many of the veteran members of this committee who have served in Iraq and Afghanistan, has a unique viewpoint and a strong voice to bring to these deliberations, and I appreciate his engagement and leadership. The security situation in Iraq and Syria continues to worsen. The Islamic State of Iraq and Syria now controls large swaths of terrain in the heart of the Middle East. In Iraq, Al-Anbar, Mosul, and Balad, all areas where countless young American men and women made the ultimate sacrifice to protect our security and to provide Iraqis a better future, have fallen under the ISIS control. Iraqi security forces have folded upon contact with ISIS. Prime Minister Maliki has failed to create a coalition government and instead has chosen to send Shia militias into Sunni tribal areas to battle ISIS, exacerbating sectarian divides and violence. Last night, I heard on the radio as I was driving home that the ISIS in Mosul are destroying religious shrines, anything that symbolizes some great treasures that have existed for centuries. They're just going through and destroying. In Syria, Bashar al-Assad remains in power. The moderate Syrian opposition has been marginalized, losing ground to both Assad and ISIS, and the foreign fighter threat has become a matter of homeland security. Meanwhile, Iran has taken advantage of this moment to further reinforce its only ally in the region, Bashar al-Assad, and expand its influence in Iraq and beyond. The landscape is incredibly complex. The sanctuary that ISIS now enjoys, the expansion that Iran is trying to achieve in this moment, and the fragile stability of the region together present strategic challenges for the United States security and our interests. The administration's disengagement and inaction since declaring victory for leaving Iraq has been disturbing. I've urged the Obama administration to engage, to look at the region holistically, and to continue and to outline a comprehensive policy and strategy for the region. However, thus far, largely what we have seen from this administration are statements on what it's not doing and proposals that lack the rigor to match the problem that we're facing. For example, we received a request for $1.5 billion for a Syria stabilization initiative in the FY15 OCO budget request that included no details. I thought our ranking member Smith said it well when he told senior defense officials that we want to be supportive, but sell us, give us something to work with. I acknowledge that there may be good options. At this point, we may be looking at the least bad of the bad options, but we need more than inaction because we cannot tolerate ISIS having sanctuary, freedom of movement, and the platform to launch attacks against the United States and our allies. And our moral leadership should not allow us to stand idly by while sectarian war engulfs the region. We're fortunate to have with us today a panel of seasoned, thoughtful experts to help the committee understand the complexity of the situation, examine the spectrum of possible courses of action, the benefits and risks of those actions, and the consequences of inaction. Again, thank you all for being here today. I look forward to your testimony and your insights. Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think this hearing is incredibly important as well. We are struggling with a very, very difficult national security and policy challenge. And I think it is the complexity of the terrorist threat that has emerged. You know, we post 9/11 developed a very good and a very effective strategy in that we knew who was coming at us. It was Al-Qaeda, their senior leadership. As General McChrystal, I think, said at the time, it takes a network to beat a network. So we built a network. We figured it out, and I think did a very effective job of going after those who had plotted and planned 9/11 and the attacks that came prior to that. The threat at that time was in Afghanistan and Pakistan. It was fairly clear. As it moved to Yemen, we responded to that. Now the problem is that it has metastasized, and we have groups, you know, spread throughout the Middle East and North Africa and into South Asia that are in alliance with Al-Qaeda's ideology, you know, the violent extremism, the extreme Islamist approach that potentially threatens the West. But how do we contain that? Which groups are the greatest threat? I mean, you can go from Boko Haram, you can go from the groups in Mali, you know, AQAP. Now we have the emergence of ISIL in Syria, in Iraq. So now we are spread very, very thin. And then we've also got, you know, individual lone actors that come out of this, folks who, you know, sign up for the jihad and then come back home, as we saw in the attack in Belgium. It is a very, very complicated picture to try to figure out how we confront that. At the end of the day, it's simple to say that what we need to do is we need to win the ideological war. We need to defeat the violent extremist ideology that is giving life to all of these various different movements that are threatening governments. But how do you do that? And I think the particularly vexing part about it is that the U.S. and pretty much all of the parts of the world where this problem is most rampant, we do not have much credibility with anybody. We don't have the ability to walk in and say we're going to fix this because there just isn't U.S. credibility in those parts of the world. And we could argue about why. It doesn't at this point really matter why. It is just a policy reality that we have to deal with as we try to figure out how do we influence things in Egypt. I was struck that during the course of the conflict there between the Muslim Brotherhood and the military folks, both sides wanted to claim that the other side was in bed with the U.S. Basically, if you could prove that your opponent was affiliated with the United States, that undermined their credibility by definition. That gives you a full flavor of the problem and the challenge. So it's not just a matter of the president or anybody else standing up and saying, here's what the U.S. is going to do, we're going to step in and fix this. It is a far more subtle and difficult policy that we have to develop. Because I will agree with the chairman, and I think the president agrees completely as well, this is a threat to our national security, beyond a doubt. It is not something simply happening a long way away that we can afford to ignore. That's not the question. The question is, what do we do about it? What are the steps that we can take that will put us in a better position? Because make no mistake about it, there are steps that we can take that would put us in a worse position. It's not a matter that action is better than inaction. We have to be smart about what we do. And to do that, we're going to rely on the four of you to tell us exactly what those smart moves are. But it is a complex and vexing challenge, and I look forward to the hearing today, and I thank the chairman for conducting it. I yield back.
Thank you, Chairman Hunter. Is your mic on?
Great to be with you and Mr. Ranking Member and all the members of the committee. This is the only committee that I would take the red eye on to get back in time for this hearing from good old San Diego. It's good to be with with folks that really care about national security, and this is a very timely hearing. Let me get right to my point here, and I have had a very abbreviated statement that I gave, and I could expand a little bit pursuant to the question period, but I think it's instructive if we're trying to figure out how to retrieve the situation in Iraq, to briefly review the history. You know, we went in March of 03, Marines on the right, 3rd ID on the left. We had the 1st Armored Division of the UK appended to the Marines. They broke off into Basra. The drive to Baghdad took less than 20 days. Saddam went down very quickly, but the occupation of Iraq proved to be very arduous, and that the Sunni population, approximately 30% of the populace, had the power. That was Iraq. That was Saddam's tribe. They had the weapons. They had the know-how, the military know-how. They also knew how to make the trains run. And when the Americans brought the idea of we were going to have one man, one vote, the Sunnis could do the math, and we made a few missteps, banning the Sunnis from high-level positions, disbanding the military totally fairly precipitously was a mistake in hindsight, but we worked through it. And when you had the twin cauldrons of Fallujah and Ramadi go up, that initiated the Sunni wars in Anbar. And simultaneously, you had the Shiite wars, almost as if they were coordinated, although they were not. Muqtada al-Sadr took on America's allies and the United States in a number of locations in eastern Iraq. So you had two cauldrons going at the same time, and there was fierce fighting in 04, punctuated by the battle for Fallujah, the final battle for Fallujah in 04. In fact, I can remember as a chairman of the committee getting a call on a satellite cell phone in the first battle of Fallujah. It was a Lieutenant Hunter who was cussing all of us for the Marines attacking and then being stopped by headquarters when we were halfway through that battle. And I assured him I would get right back with him. When I talked to the Joint Chiefs, they didn't know what was happening. In the end, they told me there was a pause, and that pause lasted for 7 months. The bad guys regrouped and hit the static Marine positions. We took some casualties because of that. So we had in the end, we took them out in the second battle for Fallujah in November, killed every Al-Qaeda and every terrorist that didn't get out of Dodge or surrender. So we had ups and downs, and that the Al-Qaeda or the Fallujah and Ramadi conflagrations basically ignited the Shiite wars or the Sunni wars in western Iraq. And we went into a very difficult period in 04 and 05 and 06, but we adapted as Americans do. And the key to winning that war, which we did in 06, when the tribes came over on our side, was that we drove a wedge between Al-Qaeda and the Sunni tribes. As you may recall, Al-Qaeda in Iraq was very brutal to the tribes. Although they were allies against the Americans, they took their women, they taxed them heavily, they assassinated the sheikhs who did not kowtow to them, and the tribes, the shine of Al-Qaeda, although they were fellow Sunnis, wore off with the tribes. And at the same time, the Americans, in between firefights, built hospitals, built infrastructure, passed out humanitarian aid. In the early weeks of April of 2004, for example, Paul Kennedy, once House liaison, Marine Corps colonel who commanded the 2nd Battalion, 4th Marines, killed 300 terrorists in 3 days in the first week of April 2004. And on the fourth day, he held medical open house at the soccer stadium in Ramadi for all the old folks in Ramadi. So here were the Americans fighting, but also trying to stitch the country together. And the Army was doing the same thing in eastern Iraq. At one point, and that was September of 2006, a Sheikh Sitar, was kind of a mid-level sheikh of the Abu Risha tribe in Ramadi, held what I call the Declaration of Independence meeting with about 30 other tribal leaders, and he announced, under the protection of Sean McFarland's guns, who was the colonel of the regiment of the 1st Armored Division that was in Ramadi, he announced that he was coming over to the American side. And within a few weeks, we had thousands of young tribesmen being directed by their leaders to come over on the U.S. side, and all of a sudden, the police force that we couldn't fill before was swelling with recruits. And in the spring and summer of 2007, we crushed al-Qaeda in Anbar province. The United States successfully drove the wedge. And we did it with a lot of military leaders who developed good relationships with the tribal leaders. General Allen went to Jordan, and he retrieved Sheikh Mishan, who came came back to his tribe in Karbala and turned his tribe against al-Qaeda. John Kelly, who was liaison to this committee for a number of years, is now Southcom. John Kelly ended up in very major positions and deployed, I believe, 5 times in Iraq. Had extremely good relationships with the senior tribal leaders in Anbar province. Joe Latoll went down into Zaidan, Lieutenant Colonel Latoll with 2nd of the 7th Marines, and wiped out al-Qaeda in the Zaidan after he made friends with the Zobai tribe in the Zaidan, and he brought the 20th Revolutionary Brigade, which was the brigade that was of old-time Sunni leaders, Sunni military leaders, who were old Saddamists, who had resisted the British. They were patterned after the group that resisted the British in the 20s. They were fighting us very effectively, side by side with al-Qaeda, in Anbar province in 2004, 2005. Joe Latoll brought them over to our side by a great counterinsurgency tactic of driving the wedge between them and al-Qaeda. They ended up helping us crush al-Qaeda. The point I'm making here is that as ISIS today comes into Anbar province and is now embedding and having their way in the cities that they've taken, is very clearly intimidating the tribes. And I don't have intelligence on the tribal leaders, what's happened to them, how many of them have been assassinated, how many of them have acquiesced. But the key to blunting the drive of ISIS in Anbar province is to retrieve the tribes, to develop some tribal resistance. Now, what they had from the Americans in 2004, 2005, 2006 is what appeared to the tribal leaders to be a strong America, who all the way from the president on down to the corporal who was carrying a Mark IV, they had a commitment to be with them to the end, to endure. They viewed the American presence as strong, as enduring. And in Iraq, you go with the winner. These are the folks who were occupied at one point by Genghis Khan. The contest was a primal contest. It was brutal, and they wanted to know who was going to win. When it appeared to them that the Americans were not only treating them better, but that we were going to prevail, they came over to our side. So if you apply that to today, to the situation today, I've got a couple of recommendations. One, you've got this great team of American leaders who have these long-lasting relationships with the tribal leaders of Anbar province and the rest of the country. You had colonels like Sutherland who put together reconciliation of the tribes up in northern Iraq. You had obviously Sean McFarland who helped to broker helped to pull Sitar into the position in which he came over to the American side. You have John Kelly, he was deputy commander of the 1st Marine Division in the invasion and was there at the end when we were taking less casualties than we were taking in Chicago, and in which congressional delegations were shopping in cities where you'd had massive firefights in the old days. John Kelly rode that horse to the very end. He has deep relationships with a number of tribal leaders. And those are assets that the United States has. So my recommendation is take these people with relationships and re-engage them with the tribal leaders. Now, you have to re-engage them with something behind you. And what you need to have behind you is the will to arm those tribes, to arm the groups that came to us during the awakening, that is anti-Al-Qaeda groups that are made up of Sunnis. And I agree that Mr. Maliki has squandered the good relationship that we built with Anbar province and with the Sunnis. But if we're to have a chance to blunt this occupation of a big piece of Iraq by ISIS, it's going to require participation of these tribes and their leaders. So the president should assemble this team. He can pull them in, and guys like Joel Dottolo have left the service. He ought to pull them in. Guys like John Kelly, instead of waiting for the next drug shipment out of Central America and his position in Southcom, have him head up the team. You obviously need to employ David Petraeus, General Odierno, who have deep relationships with leaders in the present government of Iraq, and especially military leaders, and lean on Maliki to empower the tribes. He's totally surrendered that all of the progress that we made in terms of bringing the tribes on board and bringing the Sunni dimension into the Iraqi government. So reassemble the team, re-engage with tribal leaders, and lastly, you've got several very effective units. At least you had them at the end of the war, which we won in 2008, and that is the 1st Iraqi Division, for example. They went down to Basra at Maliki's insistence. They took on Muqtada al-Sadr, wiped out the Mahdi army. They pivoted and moved 400 miles to the north, and they stabilized Baqaba and Kanakan and the regions along the Iranian border. The 1st Iraqi Division was a very effective division. It had 250 American advisors. We should reassemble the advisor team, Mr. Chairman. Bob Castelvi, Colonel Bob, then Colonel Bob Castelvi was a top advisor. We ought to find out where he's at, bring him back. He has relationships with a number of the officers, including the commander of the 1st Iraqi Division. And we should, obviously, we've done an assessment. I understand a military assessment has been done at the President and Defense Secretary Hagel's direction. And inadequacies in the 1st Division and other divisions that have some decent capability should be filled by the United States. Now, obviously, that takes cooperation from Baghdad. It's going to take a commitment by the President, and it's going to take a program of some extent to rearm and equip the Sunni tribes and organizations that came about in the movement called the Awakening, when they started to turn against Al-Qaeda. We need to reestablish that dynamic. That's a way to blunt ISIS in terms of its deepening occupation of Western Iraq. So thanks for letting me come in and give you one man's opinion. And I just want to come and see if my picture is aging gracefully, and a lot better than I am, I can see. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Biddle.
I'd like to thank the chairman and the committee for the opportunity to testify. The written submission that I provided offers a sustained analysis of U.S. options for responding to ISIL's offensive in Iraq. I'm not going to try and summarize it here. What I want to do with my time, however, is just briefly sketch its bottom lines for the committee. And in particular, the written statement argues that all the available options, of course, have serious drawbacks, but of them, the least bad is probably a combination of limited conditional military assistance designed chiefly to encourage Iraqi political reform, together with containment initiatives to make the war less likely to spread and to limit damage to the United States if it does spread. The next best option for us would be a minimalist policy of containment only with no direct military aid to Baghdad. Unconditional military aid is the least attractive choice. These options are so unattractive because of a major underlying imbalance of stakes between Americans and Iraqis that limits achievable U.S. influence over outcomes in this conflict. Iraq is already engulfed in a renewed ethno-sectarian civil war, pitting its Sunni, Shia, and Kurdish communities against one another. For Iraqis, this conflict is existential. Each community fears oppression at best and genocide at worst from its rivals, and this creates unusually bitter warfare among them. Think Syria, the Balkans, or Iraq itself in 2006. For Americans, by contrast, the stakes are real, but they're not existential. ISIL poses a terrorist threat, but terrorism with conventional weapons doesn't threaten our way of life. Not even 9/11 achieved that, and ISIL is a long way from a 9/11 attack. Iraq poses major humanitarian stakes, but the U.S. rarely uses force on humanitarian grounds alone. Probably the most direct threat to U.S. security interests is the danger that the war could spread across Iraq's borders to embroil its neighbors with both humanitarian and economic consequences for Americans. These stakes are real, but they fall short of the existential issues that Iraqis face. Economic projections suggest that even a region-wide Sunni-Shia war that took half the GCC's oil exports off the market and doubled world oil prices as a result would probably cut U.S. GDP by somewhere in the neighborhood of 3 to 5 percentage points. That's serious money. It could very well tip the U.S. into recession, and at current levels, that's somewhere between $450 and $750 billion a year in lost output. But even that is a long way from a new Great Depression. Our stakes are far from trivial, but they fall into that awkward region between the vital and the negligible. And this means that our real influence over the Iraq War's course is going to be limited. Our stakes don't support massive intervention. We're not going to send another 160,000 American ground soldiers back to Iraq at this point. But without this, Iraqis are unlikely to take risks with what they're going to see as life and death decisions just to please Americans. In particular, most regimes in sectarian wars like Iraq's try to crush their communal rivals. And this often yields long, bloody, internecine civil warfare, which historically typically runs 7 to 10 years in duration. The longer the war, the greater the danger that it spreads. For us, a settlement in the meantime that shortens the war, stops the bloodletting, and caps the risk of spread is certainly a better approach, but a settlement that would accomplish this would require major political change in Baghdad to accommodate legitimate Sunni interests and create a demonstrably non-sectarian, professionalized Iraqi army and police, neither of which exists today. These reforms are going to look dangerously risky to Iraq's Shiite regime. With its survival on the line, it's unlikely to accept such policies quickly, and the limited leverage inherent in limited U.S. assistance is unlikely to move them as far or as fast as we would like. And that leaves us with an unpleasant choice. Between helping Iraq's Shia crush Sunnis via simple unconditional aid, simply staying out altogether while containing the damage, or playing a long game strategy using conditional U.S. aid to gradually and incrementally nudge Baghdad toward the reforms necessary to shorten the war by splitting the Sunni coalition, marginalizing ISIL radicals, and settling the war before it runs its natural course. But given our limited influence, this is not going to happen quickly, and it's not going to happen easily. If we're patient, persistent, and consistent, we might be able to help shorten the war in this way, and I prefer this option for reasons that I present in my written statement, but staying out altogether is a viable alternative. The least viable of the three is simple unconditional military assistance. This is likely to reinforce Baghdad's worst instincts, to lengthen rather than shorten the war by forcing the Sunni community to dig in its heels and defend itself against what it will view as a threat of extermination, and it risks mission creep and entrapment without compensating upsides in an ability to meaningfully shorten the war. If we're unwilling to be systematically conditional, staying out would be better than that.
Thank you, Mr. Boot.
Thank you for inviting me to testify. I've finally mastered this high-tech microphone here. Push the button.
Again, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I know I speak for everybody here that it will be a very sad day when you are no longer wielding that gavel. I think you have done tremendous service, not only to this committee, not only to this Congress, but also to the armed services and to the entire country, and it's a privilege to be here with you today. I think the threat from ISIS is a clear and present.
Give him more time, Buck. You want to give him some more time.
I'll take an hour or two to give my views more fully. You know, I do think that the threat from ISIS is a clear and present danger to American national security. The fact that you now have this fundamentalist caliphate, this new state spreading across the borders of both Syria and Iraq, is something about which we ought to be very, very alarmed. The fact that Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, the self-proclaimed caliph of this new state, is saying that soon we'll be in direct confrontation with the United States is even further cause for alarm. There is very good reason why Attorney General Holder said that this is more frightening than anything he has seen in his years as Attorney General. This is a new Taliban-like state that will be a magnet for international jihadists, many of whom will wind up going to other countries and directly threaten the United States and our allies. And what makes this even worse is the impact on Shiites of this growing Sunni fundamentalism, because what we're seeing in both Iraq and Syria is that those two countries are being split between Islamist extremists of some Sunni, others Shiite. And the stronger that the Sunni fundamentalists of ISIS get, the stronger that you see the backlash, which is being led by Iran and its Quds force and its proxies, like Lebanese Hezbollah and the various Shiite militias in Iraq. It is hard to imagine a more frightening scenario from the standpoint of American interests. But, and I want to stress this point over and over again, the fact that the situation looks dire does not mean that we do not have options. It does not mean that we should just throw up our hands in despair and say, let them fight it out. That is not a good option. We have seen the fight it out option play out in Syria, where the result has been more than 170,000 dead people and the destabilization of neighboring regimes. In fact, it was the civil war in Syria which led directly to the resurgence of the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria and their ability to take over large portions of western and northern Iraq. We don't want to see this scenario play out until Jordan and other neighboring states are likewise destabilized. So what can we do to confront this horror that we face in the Middle East? Well, I think we need a strategy on both sides of the rapidly disintegrating border between Iraq and Syria. We need to keep pressure on ISIS on both sides, on both Iraq and Syria. Now, in the case of Syria, what that means, I think, is backing the Free Syrian Army, which is the only moderate element left in the fighting in Syria. Now, I will admit to you, this would have been a heck of a lot more effective if we'd done more a couple of years ago, as a lot of people urged that we should do, because we have let the Free Syrian Army basically dangle out there by themselves. They have been getting more and more marginalized as the extremists of ISIS and the Nusra Front on the one hand and of Hezbollah and the Quds Force on the other hand, as they have been going stronger and stronger. But I still think we don't really have any option other than to do what we can to buttress the Free Syrian Army, which is why I urge you to back the administration's request for $500 million in aid, even though I am very concerned about how that aid will be spent. I am very concerned when I read in the Wall Street Journal the Pentagon representatives being quoted saying that even with all that money, all they're going to do is train about 2,300 fighters for the Free Syrian Army, and that won't even start until next year. That is thinking far too small to deal with the size of the threat that we face. But while there are no great options in Syria, I do think that the Free Syrian Army has an interest in fighting our enemies, chiefly Hezbollah and ISIS. The Free Syrian Army is opposed to both. They are willing to go out there and kill people who want to kill Americans. That, to me, is a pretty good deal, and I think we should certainly support them, not with ground troops, not by putting a lot of our troops in harm's way, but simply by providing them the arms and training they need to be more effective against the extremists of both sides. Now, when we turn to what's happening in Iraq, I would certainly agree with the general consensus that Maliki has to go, and I think most Iraqis increasingly feel the same way. I'm glad that the administration seems to be committed to that policy, although I wish there was a higher level of interest in the administration in getting that job done. I'm concerned that President Obama, even to this day, has been very hands-off in his handling with Iraq. I don't think he's according it the priority that it deserves. He's been delegating it to Vice President Biden or our ambassador or others who are all capable individuals, but they don't have the power and prestige that the President of the United States has. And I think it is imperative for President Obama to get more directly involved in trying to work out a more acceptable political outcome in Iraq that would involve somebody who is more acceptable to Sunnis than Maliki becoming prime minister. But now I don't think there is a debate about to what extent we should offer military aid while this Maliki regime remains in power. I don't think we can afford to take a hands-off attitude and say, well, we're not going to help do anything at all in Iraq to check the growth of ISIS as long as Maliki is in power. That will make us feel good, but it's not going to achieve our objectives. At least I don't think it will. I certainly agree with my colleague Steve Biddle that we should not offer unconditional aid to the Iraqi armed forces as they currently stand. But I think what we need to do is we need to support all of the moderate factions in Iraq, parts of the Iraqi security forces which still continue to function well, like the Iraqi Special Operations Forces. We need to buttress them with advisors, with intelligence specialists, and also with combat air controllers who can call in airstrikes as necessary to support their attempt to push back ISIS. But at the same time, we also need to remember that the Iraqi security forces are not the only factor at play. There are also the Sunni tribes, which have been mentioned very eloquently by Chairman Hunter, and there's also the Kurdish Peshmerga. Those are all three potentially moderate elements that we can support to push back the extremists, not only of ISIS, but also of the Shiite extremists who are being backed by the Iranian Quds Force. So I think we need to be very careful to apportion our aid to all of these groups, to all of the moderates, to establish direct ties with the Sunni tribes, to establish direct ties with the Kurdish Peshmerga, as well as with certain select elements of the Iraqi security forces that we judge to be less infiltrated by the Iranian influence and the Shiite militias than other parts of the Iraqi security forces. And with all those more moderate security elements, what we ought to be doing is we ought to be providing them with advisors who are so effective in buttressing the professionalism of the Iraqi security forces prior to 2012. We ought to be providing them with more intelligence specialists. We ought to be providing them, again, as I mentioned before, with combat air controllers so they can call on American air power. If we can do that, and if we also put some of our special operations forces back in, use the very effective manhunting capability of the Joint Special Operations Command to go after terrorist networks in the way that they did in Iraq prior to 2012, those squadrons can be based in the Kurdish area, they can be based in Baghdad, they could even be based in Jordan or in parts of the Sunni triangle. If we combine all those, I think we can start to get a comprehensive strategy which can push back ISIS along with the political line of action. Now, this is certainly not calling for, you know, sending 150,000 troops and waging a major ground war. That's clearly off the table. But I think we do need to look at numbers along the lines of perhaps 10,000 personnel who would not be going into combat, who would be serving in an advise and assist capacity, aside from a very small number of Joint Special Operations personnel, and along, of course, with all the enablers, logistics, and security elements they need to be able to operate safely. I mean, that's the sort of force that our commanders were calling to keep in Iraq after 2011, and I think we've seen in the years since the cost of not keeping those forces there. I know this is going to be a tough sell. I know nobody's eager to send any troops to Iraq beyond the 820 that we've already sent there, but I think we have to be realistic and understand that we don't have any great options here. We have the least bad options, and to my mind, the worst option of all is simply leaving this terrorist caliphate in control of a significant chunk of the Middle East. I think the only way we can roll that back is with a slightly greater commitment of American resources to change the equation on the ground in both Syria and Iraq without putting American combat troops in harm's way. Final point I would make is, if we do all this, I think we do have a good chance to roll back ISIS because they are vulnerable. They are not that popular with the population that they dominate. We've seen in the past how easily the tide could turn against them, as it did in 2006, 2007. But I think American commitment, American leadership is necessary.
Thank you. Mr. Fishman.
Thank you, Chairman McKeon, Ranking Member Smith, members of the committee, for giving me the opportunity to testify today. The challenges to American interests in the Middle East could hardly be more interrelated, but I'm going to focus sharply on the danger posed by the so-called Islamic State which, as you said, Chairman, controls significant portions of both Syria and Iraq. I will get to policy suggestions, but I think there's a lot of misunderstanding, basic misunderstanding, about the Islamic State. So I'm going to give a bit of history and then comment on its strategic outlook today. The Islamic State is the current incarnation of al-Qaeda in Iraq, which was created when Abu Musab al-Zarqawi swore allegiance to Osama bin Laden in October 2004. The Islamic State of Iraq was declared in October 2006, 4 months after a U.S. airstrike killed Zarqawi. This was not just a naming convention. According to its organizers, AQI, al-Qaeda in Iraq, ceased to exist at that point, as the ISI was intended to be a governing institution independent from al-Qaeda and a practical step toward ultimately declaring a caliphate. The state has existed for 8 years. That intent of the ISI was easily overlooked because the group was weak. In 2007, the Sunni awakening and the surge undermined it almost immediately. The surge and awakening did not, however, defeat the ISI. The group retreated to northern Iraq near Mosul, where it survived by capitalizing on tension between Arabs and Kurds, utilizing the logistics networks it had long cultivated to move foreign fighters through Syria, and continued dissatisfaction among Sunnis with sectarianism in the Maliki government. Despite the setbacks, the ISI remained a capable organization even after the surge and awakening. Between 2008 and 2010, the National Counterterrorism Center tracked more terrorist violence in Iraq than any other country in the world, including Afghanistan and Pakistan. When the uprising against Bashar al-Assad began in the summer of 2011, the ISI did not have to build networks in Syria. They were already there and had been supporting its smuggling and foreign fighter operations for years. In January 2012, the ISI established an organization in Syria called Jabhat al-Nusra, which many of you know. But Nusra leader Abu Muhammad al-Jalani looked to al-Qaeda Central for strategic guidance rather than the ISI emir Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, who asserted his own authority. As a result of this disagreement, the ISI changed its name to the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant in April 2013, which reflected a de facto severing of ties with Nusra and a reaffirmation of its split with al-Qaeda. In June 2014, after finally capturing its former safe haven, Mosul, the group was clearly the strongest jihadi entity in the world and declared a caliphate with supposed authority from North Africa to South Asia. Despite the shared lineage and ideology, the Islamic State and al-Qaeda are separate organizations. They have three basic disagreements. First, whereas al-Qaeda prioritizes attacks against the U.S. homeland and Western Europe, the Islamic State does not. It prioritizes establishing political authority in the Middle East. Second, the Islamic State uses a much looser understanding of takfir than al-Qaeda, which means that it is more willing to kill Muslims, a fact that is reflected in its battles with other militants. Lastly, the Islamic State believes Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi is caliph and the supreme authority for all Muslims. Al-Qaeda has not formally responded to this claim yet, but the designation has been rejected by many senior jihadi ideologues, and I think we can expect that Al-Qaeda will be concerned about it as well. Despite prioritizing power projection in the Middle East, the Islamic State does pose a direct threat to Western Europe and the U.S. homeland. The group is so large and multifaceted that it would be surprising if some subgroups influenced by Al-Qaeda propaganda did not intend such strikes. More than 11,000 foreign fighters have traveled to Syria, including up to 3,000 from Western Europe and North America. The best academic studies suggest that 1 out of 9 Muslim foreign fighters pursue terrorism once they leave an arena like this, which is a relatively low percentage, but still suggests that a very high number may be influenced or may be interested in militancy once they go home. Moreover, the Islamic State is not just a terrorist organization. It is a proto-state. Think the Taliban pre-9/11. And it can offer safe haven to militants with more global agendas. The Islamic State's greatest weaknesses are its tenuous alliances with other Sunni factions, as discussed by everyone else on the panel. In both Iraq and Syria, these are based on compulsion and opposition to existing regimes rather than a shared vision of governance. These alliances can be broken. But in Iraq in particular, they will not be broken while the Maliki government exists as it does and governs in a sectarian way. None of the U.S. policy options towards the Islamic State are particularly attractive, but considering its strengths and weaknesses, U.S. strategy should aim to contain the Islamic State while strengthening governance in the region such that local actors can collaborate effectively to engage it decisively. Those conditions don't exist today. That means to get there, we should bolster allies on the Islamic State's periphery, such as Turkey and in particular Jordan, which is the most likely new target of the Islamic State, and destabilization there would have tremendously damaging effects vis-a-vis both Israel and Saudi Arabia. We should support vetted Syrian rebels with appropriate military assistance, limited military assistance, so long as that assistance will be sustained. Better not to provide military assistance at all than drop weaponry into a shifting battlefield and then withdraw. It's not a matter of just supporting $500 million. This has to be a long-term strategy, or we will make things worse. We need to provide conditional military assistance to Iraq. Blunting the Islamic State's military success is likely to encourage dissension among its coalition partners. And we should pursue a long-term strategy to improve governance in Iraq and Syria. This is both the most important and the most difficult of these suggestions. The goal should be to reduce ungoverned territory however possible, including by supporting regional actors like the KRG, the Kurdish Regional Government, and even Sunni factions that seek increased autonomy from Baghdad and Damascus. I don't think that we should depend on the borders as we understand them and the governments that supposedly have control over that territory. The facts on the ground simply suggest they do not. Contrary to much public discourse since the fall of Mosul, the Islamic State's rise was not sudden. Even at its nadir, it was one of the most active terrorist organizations in the world. We did not pay enough attention. Lastly, the Islamic State is not a flash in the pan. It is going to remain a significant threat to U.S. interests in the Middle East for the foreseeable future. We can contain it, as I have described, but it can only be truly destroyed in conjunction with credible local governments that do not currently exist. Thank you very much.
Thank you. In order to give more members an opportunity to question, I'm going to forego my questions at this time. We'll have Mr. Scott. Dr. Wenstrup. No questions. Ms. Walorski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the panel. And I appreciate your information. I think it's one of the best hearings that we've had on this issue that is of concern to all of us. On the issue, though, of Baghdadi, the leader, and it seems that there's not a whole lot of information flowing out and around here about necessarily who he is, but is he, how important is he to ISIS in general? I guess I'm going to direct this to Mr. Boot, anybody else that wants to chime in here. Is he is he truly the head? Is ISIS fractured? Is he really the one that calls the shots? And what is the possibility of, if he is removed, the stability of ISIS as they go forward?
Well, I think that's a very good question, and I can't purport to give you an inside scoop on the functionings of ISIS. I mean, from what I've seen, I think he is important, but we should not exaggerate the importance of any one individual leader. I mean, we saw that with the ISIS predecessor organization, Al-Qaeda in Iraq, where in 2006, JSOC managed to kill Abu Musab al-Zarqawi and thought that was a great victory against AQI, and now here we are all these years later, and it's actually more powerful than ever before. I mean, I think the history of insurgencies generally suggests that there are very few groups that are weak enough to be eliminated by the elimination of their leaders. Generally, they are these large-flung insurgencies like ISIS are strong enough to survive the elimination not only of their leader, but of an entire tier of mid to high-level leaders. We certainly should be aiming to eliminate those leaders, but it has to be done as part of a more comprehensive strategy with different lines of operation, which ultimately culminate in somebody being able to control the ground on which these terrorists seek to operate. It doesn't have to be our troops, but it has to be the troops of some allied nation. Otherwise, they will be able to simply regenerate themselves and replace any leader lost in leadership targeting. I think that's a pretty consistent historic lesson.
Thank you. Chairman Hunter, did you have a comment?
Yeah, I think that Max pointed out well. We introduced Zarqawi to a couple of thousand-pound bombs in his safe haven up by Baqaba in 2006. It didn't, but at that time, at that point, we were crushing Al Qaeda in Anbar province. But Al Qaeda was able to continue until they were defeated on the battleground. And what ISIS has is it has a lot of ongoing military operations. Ongoing military operations breed leaders. So you've got a lot of battalion leader, if you're going to analogize it to a conventional force, battalion leaders, division commanders, et cetera, you've got people who will step up, because they're obviously, in many ways, it's a disjointed operation. So you've got people who take a leadership initiative within that group, and, mm-hmm. and one of them will flow to the fore, in my estimation.
The other question I have to anybody sitting here, and I appreciate your responses, is I was in a briefing a couple of weeks ago with a former ambassador that I thought was just incredible information and kind of corroborating what you're all saying, which is this imminent threat to the United States. And are we getting ourselves to a point, or are we at the point of no return when it comes to potentially limited airstrikes, slowing down the momentum of ISIS, doing anything to throw some kind of an obstacle in their way? Or have we gotten to a point here with the inability and inaction of our administration where we won't ratchet this back in?
No. I think very, very simply, if you, once again, the first Iraqi division was extremely effective in the end in Iraq, went down, took Basra, despite the prognostications of the Washington Post, they wiped out Muqtada al-Sadr's Mahdi army in Basra, pivoted, went 400 miles north, cleared Aqaba and worked that area. And what made it so effective, one of the factors that made it extremely effective, was we had an Anglico fire team embedded, headed by a Colonel Tim Blytestel, embedded, who could bring in bomber strikes, tactical aircraft, and drones. And that gives enormous leverage to an infantry operation. If we need to find out if the 1st Iraqi Division, one question I would have is it intact? Does it still have the same leadership, like General Tariq, who mm-hmm. fought at the head of his troops, did not give ground, and fought professionally? Or has the Maliki government replaced it with some political hacks? One thing we could do, if we had I think we need to engage the people who have the relationships. Petraeus knows Maliki and knows his generals, and if they leaned on him to put competent people, not politicians, in the key positions in the 1st Division, for example, maybe the 7th Division, the 5th Division, and you in place an American fire team with the ability to bring in airstrikes, you give enormous leverage to that infantry operation with a minimum of American exposure and without a lot of what we call boots on the ground or large combat forces. First, let's find out if any of these heretofore solid military units are intact, fill up the inadequacies that they have, and if we attached American fire control teams to them, as we did in the past, they would be able to utilize American firepower coming from the air, and that would make them extremely effective, and they could isolate the cities that Al-Qaeda has taken, that ISIS has taken, and be brutal fighting, as was the Battle of Fallujah. But they could, in fact, prevail. But we need to move into people who have had these long relationships, like Petraeus and like Odierno. And incidentally, if I could expand beyond that to the Maliki question, one thing Americans don't do is look for who is the man behind the door when we all talk about so-and-so must go. I never forget the lesson we got with the Shah of Iran when we got rid of the Shah of Iran, and lo and behold, there was a Khomeini to take his place. The question would be who is going to step into the place of a Maliki who isn't massively controlled by Iran. You move that dynamic, and historically, Maliki moved to the pressure exerted by Petraeus, by the Bush government through Petraeus. He did things, he took initiatives, like going down to Basra and wiping out the Mahdi army down there. And so the idea that that's the problem, we got to get rid of Maliki and somehow we're going to have another leader come in the middle of this maelstrom of military activity, and he's going to sew the country together, or he's going to do the right thing. I think that Maliki would move to American pressure. I think he's learned to some degree the lesson of divesting himself of the Sunni element, which he did. And now the inability to have a Sunni buffer, if you will, in Anbar to hold off these extremist elements, It's probably fairly clear to Maliki.
I appreciate it. I hear the chairman banging the gavel back here.
Thanks for letting me monologue. That was a good opportunity.
That was the chairman. I want to say it's an honor to meet you, sir, and how I never thought I'd be in a room with two Duncan Hunters. So appreciate you being here today. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
It's a dubious honor.
Thank you, Mr. Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Here we are discussing the aftermath of America's longest war. There's very little member or audience interest. Perhaps more people are watching on C-SPAN, but I doubt it. I always thought the first rule of war was to understand the nature of the enemy, and I'm afraid after all these years, we're still doing a very poor job of understanding it. I have questions about who's funding ISIS or ISIL or the Islamic State, whatever name you choose to call it. They seem to be more corporate with their annual reports, with their metrics of achievements, including horrible assassinations and other maximally destructive activities. But isn't it largely true that some of our so-called allies, whether the state or individuals, like the Saudis, Qataris, Kuwaitis, are supplying the revenues for these people? To whom are the annual reports being distributed? Why do they have such a corporate fundraising empire going on?
Well, public reporting to date suggests that ISIL is unusually self-funded relative to other organizations of its kind, that they've been better than their predecessors and others at extracting revenue from the economy in which they're operating. And in part, this is because of a degree of institutionalization that you were referring to. We often tend to think of non-state actors as more or less random bands of isolated guerrillas. They can be quite bureaucratic, quite institutionalized, quite formal in their organization. And in fact, that kind of institutionalization tends to conduce to actual military power in many ways, in a much more profound way than the nature of the arms and equipment that they have. Now, ISIL is an element within what is in some danger of becoming a region-wide Sunni-Shia proxy war. They're not the preferred proxy of Saudi Arabia or other Sunni states in the region because their ability to control them is lower, and the degree to which they're worried about ISIL turning on them is larger. But the fact that there is a larger Sunni-Shia conflict going on is something we need to be seriously concerned about, and our strategy for dealing with this situation, it seems to me, needs to be oriented towards preventing the larger sectarian war from occurring. All that having been said, again, I think cutting funding ties from outside ISIL into ISIL is probably not the central factor in whether this organization will survive or not, given their unusual degree of internal funding.
Well, what you gently describe as internal funding could include rape and pillage, like when they go into a town and knock over a bank and take all the deposits for themselves.
Absolutely.
So they're more effective in their business model, and this presumably appeals to some of their Sunni patrons, because they have been looking for decades at someone to stand up to the perceived Shia peril, and they blame America for having sided with Maliki and the Iraq war, in fact, having strengthened Iran, not weakened Iran. So you're right, I think they worry about controllability of al-Baghdadi and folks like that, but this is, in many ways, a better business model, something they've been looking for some time. And of course they want deniability, they don't want obvious contacts, because that would stain their reputation. But I run into very few people who want Americans inserted between the 1400-year struggle between Shia and Sunni. And it escapes me what vital American interests are involved in that insertion. It's not as if we were super effective in our prior years and years of American service and sacrifice. We honor our troops, but there's an article in the paper today predicting that collapse in Afghanistan would happen even faster than it's happened in Iraq.
Well, I think Mr. Cooper, if I could just jump in and just to underline a point that Steve made, which I think is a very important one, which is you are seeing this regional civil war brewing. And I think when you put it the way you put it, nobody's going to say, let's put Americans in the middle of this civil war. But I think that there are very important stakes for our country and for our allies in the region, because what happens in a civil war, if it rages unabated, it strengthens the extremists on both sides. And that's what you're seeing right now. I mean, if you're worried about Saudi Arabia or Qatar or other states backing ISIS, that danger is going to grow the more that ISIS becomes the only viable and effective champion of Sunni power. If you're worried about backing for Lebanese Hezbollah and Asab al-Haq and other Shiite militias in Iraq and Syria, that funding, that support will grow among the Shiite community as long as they are seen as the only effective champions of the Shiites against Sunni oppression. I think our stake is to support the moderates, to prevent the entire region, this major center of world oil production, from being divided between Shiite and Sunni radicals. If that happens, I think that's a disaster for American interests, but I don't think that's what most people in the region want. And I think there are moderate forces, whether in the Iraqi security forces, in the Sunni tribes, the Kurdish Peshmerga, or the Free Syrian Army, who are ready to put their lives on the line to oppose the extremists of both sides if we will only provide them with a relatively modest degree of support.
Thank you. Ms. Hartzler.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to follow up on a lot of the discussions already taken place. First, starting with Maliki. Some of you and a lot of people say Maliki needs to go, and then I've heard also that we need to push back and influence Maliki to do the right thing. And then I hear some concerns from you, Chairman, that I wonder about also as far as if he goes, who's going to replace him? And look at what happened in Libya and Gaddafi and the other conflicts that we've had and that sort of thing. So I guess first I want to start off with whether you think Maliki should go, and if he does, who should replace him, or how should the U.S. prepare for that transition in power? And then if it is a matter of influence, what are some specific steps that we can do to encourage him to expand his government to include Sunnis in it? And then also, if we have time, to share a little bit about what the role of Iran is in the conflict now, and then what lessons we could learn with Afghanistan. So yep. A lot to work with there. So who wants to start?
let me jump in and give it a try. First, what I would do, what I would recommend that the president do, is take the people that had the longest standing relationship with Maliki and the most successful relationship. That's Mr. Crocker and General Petraeus, and send them over to look this thing over. And engage with Maliki and bring them back in and ask them, what do you think? Do you think that Maliki, that a relationship with Maliki is retrievable in a way that we can move him to reconcile with the Sunni community to the degree that you'll have some pushback in Anbar province among the moderate tribes against ISIS? Or is that gone? Has he irretrievably, by the things that he's done with respect to the Sunnis in his own government and the region, is that train departed? But that's the simple answer, is to take the people that have the relationship, send them over, have them engage with Maliki, have them look at this thing. People that you relied on and you talk to every day, or the administration and our security apparatus talk to every day, and ask them. My sense is Maliki was a typical leader in that neighborhood. He's a guy that wants to get through the night. He has moved to American pressure. When we pressured him to send money to Anbar province to share the wealth, he did it late in the war. When we pressured him to allow competent generals and to have a fairly large Sunni presence in the Iraqi army, the first Iraqi division had 30% Sunnis, 60% Shiites, the balance Kurds. He did that. So he moved to American pressure and American leadership. And I think that the president should ask that assessment to be made by the people that worked with him for the longest period of time and had the most success with him. That's rather than simply saying, Matt. And the other point is, this is not a Sunni, ISIS doesn't represent a Sunni community. The Sunni community is not a united community in Anbar province any more than the tribes who initially accommodated al-Qaeda as they flowed down the rat line of the Euphrates and moved into Fallujah and Ramadi, into those conflicts. The Sunni community got beat up by al-Qaeda. That's one reason they split off from them, turned and came over on our side and helped us crush al-Qaeda. The 20th Revolutionary Brigade, which was the ally at one time of al-Qaeda in a region known as the Zaidan, turned on them and killed every one of them that didn't get out of Dodge, with the Americans behind them, not leading them, but behind them. So the point is that this is not a... I don't think there's anything that the leader in Baghdad, a Shiite leader, can do that will mollify the terrorists who are coming across, known as ISIS. I think what he could do is accommodate, retrieve that relationship that they had developed at one point with the Sunni tribes, which was a decent relationship. After the first Iraqi division took on Muqtada al-Sadr in Basra and wiped out his forces there, Muqtada al-Sadr got 5% in the next election. His party did. The Iraqi people did not like a Shiite who was aligned with Iran. And the Sunnis came back into the government. They said the Maliki government's not just beating up on Sunnis, they're taking on Shiite forces too. So there's nothing we can do to reconcile with ISIS. And ISIS's positions and their strategy and their goals are not at all consistent with the Sunni tribes in Anbar. Sunni tribes are accommodating them right now because they're intimidated by them. And I suspect that if we see the intelligence reports, and there are any intelligence reports, Jim Cooper said one problem we've had is decent intelligence. We'll probably see that a number of leaders in those tribes who pushed back have been assassinated.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Shea Porter.
Thank you. It's nice to see you again, Mr. Hunter. And I keep reflecting back to 2007 and where we were and what some of the predictions were. And sadly, you know, those who predicted trouble in the future in Iraq have proven to be accurate. But one of the great problems that we have, as you know, is the sequester. So for those who support a more active role, and particularly you, Mr. Hunter, because you were in Congress, you understand the sequester. I know you know what's happening with some of the changes. And while we were in the Iraq War, we also had tax cuts, and we wound up with a great deal of debt, which is now very threatening and concerning to not just Congress, but to the American people. So what's the price tag? Never mind whether we should or we shouldn't do the things that you suggested and Mr. Boot's looking at. What's the price tag, and what would you say to Congress about how to pay for it? Would you suggest that we continue to borrow the money? Would you say that maybe we need to have war bonds? If we were to do the action steps that you're calling for, how would we pay for it?
Well, first, big picture, John Kennedy spent 9% of GNP on defense. Ronald Reagan spent 6% of GNP on defense. We're down to about 4, even with Iraq and Afghanistan. So in terms of the proportion of American money that we spent on defense, we've declined. And we've now made massive cuts with per sequestration and budget cuts in the defense apparatus, far below what I think is what I would call the safety line. So I think we're spending less in terms of the national economy than we've ever spent in our history, and we're going to have a much smaller force. So, secondly, the Iraq things that or Iraq initiatives, for example, having fire support teams, as we did in the 2007-2008 in Iraq with some of the Iraqi divisions, that to give leverage to them of American air power, very small cost for the embedded teams. I mean that's nothing like the divisions that we had over there as foot soldiers.
Right, but let me interrupt here if you don't mind,
okay.
Because I'm against the sequester. I mean, I agree that this has been damaging, but the reality is that, you know, our Congress is not willing to find a way and actually has supported the sequester. So the reality remains that whether I agree or disagree with what you've suggested, we have that practical issue of how do we pay for it? Do we borrow the money, or do you see a change in Congress? And how would we actually do this?
Okay. My recommendation would be, and I think my voting record reflected that, would be to cut the, I think we're moving in the dynamic of most of the Western nations, especially the socialized nations, in that social spending is pressing down on defense spending. That's why you got some of our allies that are in Europe now spending 1% of GNP or less on defense. I think we should freeze, for example, domestic discretionary. We should make cuts in the social spending and push that spending back to the point where it will accommodate a 5 or 6% of GNP being spent on national security. I think it's a tragedy that with the rise of China stepping into the superpower shoes left by the Soviet Union, with the problems in the Ukraine, the new Russian adventurism, all the problems in the world, we are cutting defense. We're not increasing.
Right, and again, the issue is, and I'm just trying to get us to.
So I would cut social spending.
Because I think, you know, we need those social programs, but I think we need a strong defense as well. And so what we're talking about, I think we're asking people to choose from two essentials, to rob Peter to pay Paul, essentially. And that's concerning. I think our whatever policy
reflects reality. Paul, except for one thing, Paul is down to 4%. If Paul is defense, Paul is down to 4% of GNP being spent on defense. The social spending has increased steadily as defense has diminished. So
I see where you are. I just wondered if you.
It's not hard to see.
You had a view about how to do this.
If I could just.
Dr. Biddle, can you suggest a way, or do you see a way through this, knowing the economic pressures that we have? Does your plan fit, your most acceptable plan or least disagreeable plan, does that fit in with the reality of this Congress?
I don't think the primary downside of conditional military assistance is its cost. Even the program that Max is suggesting, which would probably be larger than I would recommend, the usual rule of thumb is to support an American soldier overseas for a year is about $1 million. So even a 10 or 15,000 soldier American presence in Iraq, if one were going to do that, and I'm not sure I would support that personally, and certainly I would not support it without major political change as the price of providing whatever we provide, the downside peril to that is not so much its upfront dollar cost, it's the risk that the policy fails and we get entrapped. And we get caught in a larger commitment in which mission creep gradually draws us further into a problem that we've been unable to solve. So I think paying for it is in many ways the least of the downside difficulties associated with this. Getting the policy to actually change Iraqi behavior on the ground is a much bigger risk.
Because what we did see was that mission creep, and we saw promises that didn't materialize. I remember somebody here one time saying that we would be seeing Iraqi products on the shelves within a certain number of months, and that didn't happen. So we have to consider all of this as we try to formulate a policy going forward. Our security, our national security is critical, along with our social programs. So thank you for your candid answers, and I yield back.
An honor here for me to say just a quick word of greeting to the Chairman Hunter. I didn't get to be here at the beginning. There's no way I could have helped that, but it is just a precious honor to see you again. All of us recognize your legacy, and it's in that spirit that I now recognize Mr. Hunter too.
Thank the Chairman. This could be fun if I was, especially if I was taking advantage of this situation to.
I've been dreading this
to
moment.
To bludgeon the witness due to real or imagined trauma from the past. But I guess here's, and this is kind of easy because I think I've heard everything that Mr. Hunter has to say on this subject. So I'm going to ask a broader question. Maybe some of the other panels could answer. I guess the first question is, no one's talked about a political end state or what we would have to describe in our policy is that here's what we want to see in the next 10 years and here's why we're doing all of this. When does that come into play, and wouldn't the president have to be the one to set that? And tying in with that is, what can Congress do with the commander-in-chief that doesn't want to engage? And if the other witnesses could maybe start and move left this time, Mr. Fishwood.
Sure. You know, this is about the meanest thing you can do.
I get the hard one. The political end state here, the only reasonable political end state is a scenario in which, as long as there is civil war in Syria and Iraq, the Islamic State will persist, period. It will not go away under those conditions. And yet, there's obviously no clear end state to the civil war in Syria. I think the chances that Bashar al-Assad falls are dropping daily. And so I think, and I'm deeply skeptical, frankly, that even if Prime Minister Maliki steps aside, that a government is going to step into Baghdad and govern on behalf of all Iraqis. Call that cynicism, I don't know. But it's very unlikely, I think, that some of the Sunni tribes, who I agree with Chairman Hunter's assessment, that were good allies, that potentially can be allies in the future, but I am skeptical that they're going to accept a policy framework that would be acceptable to any Shia government in Baghdad without guarantees, you know, extraordinary guarantees of safety and support from the United States, such as existed in 2006 and 2007 when we had 150,000 troops on the ground. Without those conditions, I don't know if they are going to take the risks to turn on the Islamic State as they did turn on al-Qaeda in Iraq and the Islamic State of Iraq. And so, unfortunately, we come to suboptimal suggestions, which is that I think we need to start looking, frankly, beyond the existing state entities of Syria and Iraq. And I think that this is a de facto reality. The border between these two states is essentially meaningless. It's a map maker's whim at this point. And I think the policy outcome or we need to start looking to bolster stability wherever it exists. That means the most obvious of those in that region is the Kurdish regions. As they pursue autonomy, I think that's something that we shouldn't publicly endorse the declaration of a state, but I do think we should support their ability to govern autonomously as much as possible, and I think we should find ways for them to generate oil revenue on their own, independent of Baghdad, as controversial as that is, and as problematic as that will be. And I think we should identify the narrow vetted Syrian organizations that can govern, whether they're remnants of the Free Syrian Army, that can build out and carve out entities of governance. We have to limit the area of instability as much as possible, and I don't think we can run that through Damascus and Baghdad.
Thank you. Mr. Boot.
I pretty much agree with all of that. I think it is, I mean, it does, the situation does look pretty bleak today, but I'm reminded of the words of General Petraeus in 2007 when he took over in Iraq, and he said, it's hard, but hard is not hopeless, and I agree with that. I think that there are pockets of moderation that we can build on in both Iraq and Syria, and, you know, as Brian suggested, I would be agnostic over how many states will emerge out of the rubble of Iraq and Syria. I don't think we should necessarily be committed to supporting the existing state structures, but we shouldn't dictate and say, here's how you divide it up either, because we don't have the knowledge or the ability to do that. And it's not an easy solution anyway, because, you know, you can easily imagine a scenario in which, in fact, which is already happening today, with Iraq being split up into three states, but two of them are controlled by Islamist extremists, one Shiite, the other Sunni. That's not good news from our perspective. Our policy should be to back however many states ultimately emerge, even if it's two, maybe it's more, whatever the number is. Our strategy should be to back the moderates in all those states, and I firmly believe that the vast majority of people are, in fact, moderates, but under conditions of anarchy and chaos, they tend to gravitate for protection to extremist militias, and so we need to bolster more moderate forces, as I suggested before, elements of the Iraqi security forces, the Sunni tribes, the Kurdish Peshmerga, and the Free Syrian Army. That's where we need to be building, and at the moment, you can easily say, well, there's not a heck of a lot to build on, but I think that there is a lot of popular unease and resentment with the rule, whether of Lebanese Hezbollah or the rule of ISIS or other extremist groups. They are not gaining power via the ballot box. They are not winning popularity contests. They are shooting their way into power, and they are causing a lot of resentment along the way. They are running roughshod over existing power structures, over existing social structures, and I think there is the popular discontent there, as there was in 2006, which can be mobilized. The difference being now, we're not going to do it with 150,000 troops. We got to pursue a more unconventional warfare model, as we did, for example, in Afghanistan in the fall of 2001, when we backed the Northern Alliance with American air power and American special forces to bring down a very unpopular Taliban. I think that's a model we should be applying in Iraq and Syria today.
I think I'm out of time. I yield back.
Mr. Chairman, don't I get to answer the gentleman's question?
Yes.
I would. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would say what we could achieve is something of what we had at the end of the American victory in Iraq in 2008, and that was what I would call grudging accommodation. You may recall Maliki actually traveled to Anbar province and sat down with Sunni leaders at the prodding of American General Petraeus, I'm sure, and other Americans, and dispersed some of the wealth, some of the public wealth, did a series of public works projects in Anbar province. So the Sunni-Shiite cleavage is not going to be healed by the United States or anybody else, but we could retrieve what I would call that grudging accommodation. It would have to be fueled with money. That means they would have to be sharing revenues, which is something that the old sheikhs of the tribes in Western Iraq very much understand and appreciate. So sharing of money, a grudging accommodation, the present structure of government would work with their representative government if they weren't killing each other with AKs. So you got to have a dose of conciliation. The only people that have been able to persuade leadership in Iraq to be conciliatory in any situation that I know of is the Americans, and that's what we did in 07, 08. I think we could do that again.
I thank the gentleman. We're now, Ms. Gabbard.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen, for being here. Mr. Boot and Mr. Fishman, it's been refreshing to hear, in particular from both of you, your direction in addressing this issue, directly taking on the fact that we have to address both Syria and Iraq in the same conversation, and that the objective needs to be on how we deal with the threat of ISIS and the impact that they're having there. First and foremost, and understanding that the governance question really needs to be self-determined by the people who are living there. So in this strategy to address ISIS, both of you have spoken of supporting vetted Syrian rebels. Last week we heard from some leaders in the Pentagon who also were making the pitch for the $500 million appropriation. But when asked the question about what's the objective of this support and what do we hope to accomplish, is it to overthrow Assad or is it to deal with the threat of ISIS? The basic answer I got back was both, and that's contradictory at this point, because by helping overthrow Assad, you're helping to create the vacuum that ISIS is seeking to take advantage of. If we're helping the Syrian rebels fight against ISIS, that goes to this objective of the problem that we're seeing in the region. So I guess my question for both of you is, in your advocating for this support from the US, how do you determine that these weapons won't go into the hands of al-Nusra, al-Qaeda, others, and to what objective?
So thank you very much for the question. I agree very much that there is a tension between our policy interests in Syria, and that has often gone unacknowledged in our policy conversations about this. We like to think we can have it all. In Syria, we cannot. $500 million is not going to solve either of these problems in Syria. And I think we should be very clear about this. And I think that this sort of funding, what worries me about $500 million is that it's not enough to, you know, have any major strategic impact, but it's enough that it sort of is tempting to sort of go beyond very, very narrow vetted organizations. My preferred strategy actually would be to support a very narrow set of organizations in Syria that can pester ISIS and give us a foothold on the ground. I don't think we are going to solve that problem within that sort of budget range. I think that solving that problem is a multi-year solution that would cost tens, if not hundreds of billions of dollars. I just don't think this goes away. But I slightly disagree with your framing on the Assad regime versus ISIS. I think that what benefits ISIS the most is the continuation of conflict, not necessarily the fall of the Assad regime. It's the continuation of conflict and the fear within the Sunni communities that they try to resolve that gives them access and allows them to win over those folks that Chairman Hunter was referring to. The last just quick point is that there is risk with us becoming directly engaged here at all. The Islamic State is not focused on external attacks right now. It very clearly prioritizes establishing governance in the Middle East. To the extent that we get more and more involved, and especially if we use direct military force, we raise the risk that the Islamic State will allocate more resources towards attacking the West. And while I think there are circumstances in which we should suffer that cost, I think we should be very clear-eyed that that is a reality.
Thank you. Mr. Boot?
Well, I'd just say, while that's a real risk, I think the greatest risk of all is doing nothing and letting the Islamic State consolidate its authority over large portions of Iraq and Syria, which is what's happening now. I mean, I think you raise a very good question about how to safeguard that aid, and I think there is certainly a cautionary lesson from Afghanistan in the 1980s, but we have to recognize why there was so much blowback in Afghanistan, and part of the reason for that is that we were operating through proxies, in particular through the Pakistani ISI and Saudi intelligence, who were funneling our aid to some of the most Islamist and radical Mujahideen fighters like Hekmatyar and Haqqani, as opposed to the more moderate fighters like Ahmed Shah Massoud. In the case of Syria, I would strongly caution we not repeat that mistake. We should not operate through Saudi or Qatari or other intelligence services who may have a different agenda than we have. I think our intelligence folks need to get much more directly involved in vetting the people we are supporting and providing aid to them directly so we know exactly who we're backing. And in terms of what that can achieve, you know, at the moment, overthrowing Assad seems like a long way off, but certainly in the short term at least, I think that with more support, the Free Syrian Army can do real damage to both the forces of the Quds Force and Lebanese Hezbollah on one side, and on the other side, ISIS and the Nusra Front. And, you know, whatever damage we can do to them, I think will be very much in our interest, and will tie them down in Syria and prevent them from consolidating control and make it harder for them to even think about external plots.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Lamborn.
Mr. Chairman, and Chairman Hunter, it's great to see you again, and I'm glad that you are engaged and sharing your experience and your wisdom with us, so I appreciate that. I'd like to ask about the Kurds. I've been distressed that the administration hasn't done more, and I could give you many examples of allying with people who are naturally friendly and supportive of the United States, and trying to work as opposed to working more with opponents or enemies who we get very little back in return. So with the Kurds, should we be doing more to establish relationships with them in Iraq or even in nearby countries? And I know we have strong ties with Turkey that we don't want to see go away, and with Iraq for that matter, but can we and should we be doing more with the Kurds? Any one of you.
Well, I would say we need a force right now to stand up to this invasion and this occupation. If the Kurds end up being the only hard point, absolutely, that accrues to the detriment of ISIS and to the benefit of the of what we want, which is an Iraq which is devoid of ISIS. So they may be the only stand up force if we don't do some of the things that we talked about here, like shaping up the Iraqi forces, bringing about some conciliation, and also re-engaging with our old Sunni allies. The Kurds may be the last strong point, against this force, and absolutely we should work with them and help them.
Any of you others?
Our primary interest in this conflict is to stop the fighting and prevent it from spreading. There may be some ways in which U.S. policy towards Kurdistan can contribute to that larger outcome, and my written statement describes some of them. But there's also a serious danger that if we focus on Kurdistan per se, we could end up making things worse rather than better for the larger conflict. This is a highly mobilized ethno-sectarian identity war in which the Kurds have mostly been able to stand on the sidelines but are not unimplicated in this larger conflict. If the United States simply aligns itself with one side and loses leverage over the other two, there's some risk that what we end up doing is encouraging the spread of conflict. I think the central challenge for the United States right now is if we are going to engage to the point where we're going to try and have some influence over the outcome rather than standing aloof and trying to limit our downside losses, the only way we're going to actually end the conflict is if we get some kind of mediated power-sharing deal among the parties in which they all believe that they're protected against worst-case downside outcomes. Bitterness, fear, and jealousy between Kurds and Arabs is part of this problem. And a simple American alignment with the Kurds that's not part of a larger diplomatic strategy for reassuring Sunni and Shia that their interests will also be respected is not necessarily a way to stop the war before it engulfs the region.
Mr. Boot?
I mean, I would certainly agree with that. We don't want to be seen solely as the champions of the Kurds, but I think we certainly should take advantage of the pro-Western orientation of the Kurds and the relative safe environment that they would offer and the relatively professional military forces that they would offer to operate alongside American forces. I mean, we can easily, for example, base JSOC squadrons in the KRG where they could operate pretty effectively into Mosul and other parts of northern Iraq. I think we ought to be doing that at the same time as we are also operating with the Sunni tribes as well as with elements of the Iraqi security forces to make clear that we are not choosing sectarian sides in this conflict going on in Iraq, but I think it would be foolish not to take advantage of the open invitation the Kurds have given us to station forces in their territory. I think we should do that.
I agree with Professor Biddle's concerns about this. The tension between Arabs and Kurds in Mosul is one of the factors that allowed the Islamic State in Iraq to survive there after the defeats it suffered in Anbar, after the awakening and the surge. The challenge here, though, is that I don't see a negotiated solution. I think that the accommodation that we came to in 2007, 2008 was a function of the leverage provided by our ground forces on the ground. Those don't exist, and I don't hear a lot of interest in pursuing that kind of commitment again. And so to be quite blunt, I don't think we have the leverage to produce that sort of accommodation. And I think we are now from my perspective, having a conversation about those next tier suboptimal outcomes.
Thank you all for being here.
Well, thank you, Mr. Lamborn. Thank all of you for being here. I would express again a special greeting to Chairman Hunter. Your legacy obviously lives on in this committee, and we're all so very grateful that you're here. You know, it occurs to me, Chairman Hunter, that one of the original objectives of the jihadist mindset after 9/11 was to try to gain some sort of base of operations with which to launch terrorist attacks and jihad, as it were, across the world. And it appears that they haven't given up that objective at all. And sometimes our administration seems willing to stand back and not engage to the extent that the central question here, the central strategic engagement here, is one of why jihadists feel transcendentally justified to do this. And until we call it for what it is, it's difficult then to bring the tactics to bear. But now it seems like the administration is almost unwilling to even consider tactics to bear. So ISIS, as we know, is rampaging across Iraq, and after dismissing ISIS as a threat, the administration has finally conceded that they are, quote, worse than Al-Qaeda. And you know, now that they're moving on a country, on the city of Nineveh, a city that has withstood 8,000 years of even biblical challenges, this administration has managed to put Nineveh at risk after 6 years. So my question to you, Mr. Hunter, given the incredible danger that ISIS represents, I mean, Christian community is almost extinct now in Iraq, how did we get here? Where was a time when things were on track. Where did we fail? And what is this situation now? What can we do now? If you had been president, which some of us wish that would have occurred, if you had been president, how would you have prevented where we have come to find ourselves? And what would you do now in the untenable position that we find ourselves in now?
Well, Mr. Chairman, first, thanks for letting me come and share the dais here with these gentlemen who have a lot of expertise in this area, and it's been great coming back to the committee, I mentioned during my remarks at one point when I was chairman, my son, Mr. Hunter, the gentleman from California, called me. He was a captain in the Marine Corps in the Battle of Fallujah. Called me on the satellite cell phone and said, "What are you?" And he had some fairly uncomplimentary words for all political leadership. "What have you done? We've just been ordered to stop attacking. We're halfway through the Battle of Fallujah. We've got them reeling, and we've been given an order to stop." And in fact, that had happened. Mr. Bremer had gotten cold feet. He'd been pressured by the Sunnis. And so he essentially ordered, even though he wasn't in the chain of command. He was followed by the combat leadership in Iraq. We stopped the attack at midpoint. We stopped our operation. The bad guys rallied, and they inflicted some pretty severe casualties on the Marines, who are now in static positions. To some degree, that's a reflection of this conflict. I think that one thing that we see now that we Americans appreciate is that this conflict has legs. It's an enduring conflict. And it's also a conflict that doesn't come wrapped in neat packages. There have been great questions about we're going to help these people, or we're going to help these people, and implicit in those questions were, where is the white hat? Where are the good people? Where are the moderates? Where's the moderate leader? Because you can have great people in a region, but if you've got a leader that's a throat cutter, the persona of the people is not relevant. So this is a very difficult area of the world in which shifts like the sands of Anbar. And what we have to do, I think, are practical things. And the practical thing we could do right now is to try to blunt that attack. We don't know if we're going to see a post-Maliki leader in Iraq who is not worse than Mr. Maliki for all of the problems that have been manifested in his time in office. He's also moved under American leadership to do some things that we wanted him to do. This is an enduring struggle. There is no, there's going to be no surrender on the battleship Missouri. So it's going to be one that's going to be with our children, with young people that are now 5 and 6 years old are going to be in the armed services of the United States, deploying to parts of the world 15 years from now to engage in parts of this struggle. What we have to do is have people of judgment in leadership positions, and we have to take action quickly. And it's tough in this democracy to bring people to take action quickly. And I think one thing we would all agree on is we do need to take action, and it needs to be taken quickly because time is fleeting, time is of the essence. The more the ISIS forces embed in Iraq, the more difficult it's going to be to dislodge them. They were really most vulnerable when they were flowing in high numbers and were in transit and could have been taken out at that point with American air power. They could have been taken out with some Iraqi air power, in fact, if logistically supplied by the Americans. But there's no easy answer here. And there are people who read that their Quran in such a way that they believe that this is their, as those people on the airliner on 9/11 who had a copy of the Quran. There are people who read that and will continue to read it as being their mission is to destroy Americans. also in many cases to destroy fellow Muslims, as we've seen in these conflicts. The most difficult factor we have here is the ability to identify moderate, effective leaders who will be good leaders, good people, who will not engage in brutality, will not polarize under pressure to the extremes. That's a tough one to do. It's a tough one to find. And we're seeing that same problem in Afghanistan. The post-Karzai government, we think we're hopeful will be a much better one. But that's the problem. And that's one that we have to live with. So what we have to do is be strong, militarily robust. We're sliding down we're losing a great deal of our military strength. If you've seen all the force projection numbers, we have to maintain strong special operations capability. We also have to have in the executive department and the president the ability to call shots quickly and move quickly. And right now we don't have that. And I think time is against us in the Iraq with respect to the Iraq situation.
Well, again, thank you for your service to humanity and the cause of human freedom, Chairman Hunter. And I'm going to give everyone a chance just to say a brief closing thought here before we adjourn the committee. We'll start with you over here, Mr. Eichmann.
Mr. Chairman, thank you again for having me here today and to the entire committee. As everyone has discussed, our options in facing the Islamic State are suboptimal. And I think that considering that, the best course of action is to contain this organization, to attempt to strengthen local governance, and to wait while this group makes mistakes, which it will. Jihadi organizations from Algeria in the 80s to Afghanistan to Iraq 8 years ago are prone to make mistakes. They are prone to alienate the people that they live with and their constituency. And I think we can put ourselves in a position to capitalize on that when the time comes, but I'm skeptical that we will be able to destroy this organization anytime soon. It's going to be a persistent threat.
Yes, sir, Mr. Boot.
Well, I think it's true that over time, extreme Islamist groups do alienate the people they rule, but I don't think we can afford to wait for some inevitable backlash to occur, because I think the longer that ISIS has to consolidate its authority, the greater the threat to us will be, the more the chances are that foreign jihadists will be on its territory training for conflicts in other places, including quite possibly the United States and Western Europe. So I think we need to act. We're not going to act with overwhelming American military force on the ground. That is clearly not in the cards. But we do have potential allies that we can support and push forward into the fight with American advice, with American intelligence, with American weapons, and in some cases, with American air power called in by American eyes on the ground. This is a very limited commitment, but I think it is one that is well warranted by the alarming situation we face today in Iraq and Syria. And I think we ought to be giving serious consideration to sending a force on the order of perhaps 10,000 personnel, mostly in an advisory and assistance capacity, as I suggested earlier, to Iraq to work with the various elements, not only of the Iraqi security forces, but the Kurdish Peshmerga and the Sunni tribes. That's a force, by the way, roughly similar to the size that we're leaving in Afghanistan. And I think it is vitally important to have that kind of continuing American presence in Afghanistan, because if that doesn't happen, then Afghanistan could fall apart as easily as Iraq has done. And I think we should learn, now that Iraq has fallen apart, the situation becomes much more difficult, but it's still not impossible. And I think with a relatively modest American commitment, I think we're not going to necessarily eradicate ISIS, but we can certainly dislodge it from controlling as much territory as it has and put it more on the defensive and more on the run. I think that should be our immediate short-term objective, leading ultimately to trying to crush the group, as we in fact did successfully in 2007, 2008 with the support of the Sunni tribes of Anbar province.
Dr. Biddle.
As I hear the panel, we disagree at least at the margin on how serious the threat is here and what the scale of U.S. interests engaged are. We all think there are important interests engaged. The scale of them, I think there's some degree of disagreement. The panel also agrees that conditional assistance is the appropriate way forward for trying to realize the stakes we have involved. I want to emphasize, though, that although we agree that some degree of conditional military assistance is an appropriate way forward, the scale of leverage we can develop through assistance of the kind that any of us are interested in providing, even my friend and colleague Max is not talking about sending 160,000 American troops back to Iraq. Given the scale of the assistance we're willing to offer, the scale of the leverage it's going to provide is going to be correspondingly small. And the danger of slipping from a policy of conditionality to generate leverage into commitment and unconditional aid because our conditions weren't met and we decided now we're committed and we have to act anyway, or because our conditions were met initially and then there was backsliding later, and Maliki's successor reneges on initial commitments, these are very serious risks. And if we are going to take seriously the idea that conditional aid is going to be used as a lever to produce political accommodation in Baghdad that will enable a split in the Sunni coalition and an earlier settlement to the war, we're talking about a difficult, complex, political-military tug of war with not just Maliki while he's in office, but any successor who might come after him. And we should not underestimate how challenging that will be for the U.S. government to pull off. I think there are existence proofs that at various times and at various places, the U.S. has been able to accomplish this. I think I agree with Chairman Hunter that General Petraeus and Ambassador Crocker were particularly astute at using sticks and carrots and conditional leverage to change the interest calculus of Nouri al-Maliki in particular and the government of Iraq in general while they were in leadership positions in Iraq. But we have not been consistently outstanding in our achievement of this goal in the past. And if we are not serious about persisting in a long-term political-military strategy that, if it goes wrong, could produce terrible consequences, I don't want us to fail to take seriously the alternative of, in fact, not making things worse by staying out.
Mr. Hunter.
First, my recommendation to support the tribes is not a conditional one. Not based on anything that Maliki could do. Any of I think we should send our the president and the secretary of defense could pull this team together. They would respond immediately, and a number of them are still in service to this nation and other locations. And in other positions, and re-engage the tribes, and any tribes that are willing to oppose ISIS, we help them without any political conditions established outside of that they will oppose ISIS. I think any conditional aid with respect to the government of Baghdad, obviously, I think what I would do without extracting political conciliation or political concessions from Maliki is to inventory the main divisions of the Iraqi army. And if they have inadequacies, to meet those inadequacies, if they will turn that army, if they will utilize it aggressively against ISIS. And you know, once again, the 1st Iraqi Division was a good division, was effective at the end. They stood and fought, they held, they took ground, they worked professionally. One thing that I haven't seen is an analysis of what's happened to that to the 1st Division, the 7th Division, and several other divisions were fairly good, not as good as those, but fairly good. And it's difficult to believe that they've deteriorated to the point where they can't take on guys who are coming in with 50 cals on Toyota pickup trucks, especially with the armor element that they possess right now and with a very limited air element. So I think you're not going to achieve any concessions that you can achieve politically from this government can, as we know, be changed very quickly by another government. And there will always be the Sunni-Shiite split, and there will always be that dynamic playing in that government. if we can nurture along what I called a grudging accommodation, which is what the Shiite government in Baghdad had for Anbar in the late years of the war, that's a victory. And if we could, but that's dependent on votes. You know, this is like Turkey. We urged them to take a vote. We taught them democracy when we wanted to send the 4th Division through Turkey. They took a vote. It was against us. And because of that, we couldn't move the 4th Division through. So we don't know which way this government's going to go. We know there will always be a bias. There will always be the pressure from Iran. There will always be the Shiite majority. And that fissure between Shiites and Sunnis will always be ready to widen into a Grand Canyon. That's just a tendency that will be there. I think we have to live with that. But I would unconditionally support the tribes that will push back against ISIS and unconditionally support the equipping and utilizing American air leverage for the Iraqi army pushing back against ISIS. And once again, that would have to be a very well-monitored operation, because it would be against ISIS, not against the tribal elements in Anbar province.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. It certainly occurs to me that when you consider ISIS and how quickly they have risen, that it's reminiscent of a bunch of idiots, lunatics riding across France on bicycles wearing brown shirts. And when the Nazis finally began to find resonance, it was certainly dangerous to the world. And it's important that we prevent that from occurring here. And I hope that the vacillation and uncertainty doesn't begin to precipitate that very paradigm. And with that, I want to thank all of you for coming today, and I'm glad you're on our side. This meeting is adjourned.
Thank you. Thank you. Hey, gentlemen, great to be with you.